I am just wondering whether she's in touch with the man's family. Because if she is, then of course it will be easy to get more information. Is it that the man is no more interested in the relationship? Is that his way of telling her that, you can move on? Or there is whatever, maybe a legitimate problem, maybe that the family would be able to, let her know. So what I'd like to advise is this, that she should first try and contact the man's family and hear from them, because it would be quite precarious for her to move on with this new person, only for the old one to also surface. It could create a lot of confusion. And if, as we are saying, as the saying goes, "Lai Momo is anything to go by," then she may find herself in a real difficult situation. But if she is very, very sure that the man has worked out, and that is the reason why he is not communicating, if she has heard filler from other sources that, he is with another lady and blah, 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 and that is why you are not hearing from him, and she is very convinced that that is the situation, then of course her decision to go on with this new one may be in the right direction. But even then, it will still be the proper thing to do to contact the man's family and let them know that, well, this and this is what I have heard, and your son has moved on. So I would also want to move on with my life. Things done by halves are never done right. So I think that if, depending on the scenario, she would be able to take a firm decision. If the man has moved on, then yes, you can also move on. If he hasn't, and the family is in touch with him, and they tell you that, oh, it's because of A, B, C, D, and so hold on, then she may want to do that. So, based on the information given, this is the counsel that I would have to share with her.
Reverend Agre, would you want to add on?
I think I support my colleague, Reverend Derek. From what the lady is saying, it's clear that she doesn't have much information about the gentleman. And somebody who has been away for a whole year, and no communication. On what information are you going to, engage such a person and live with for a long, I mean, for the rest of your life? So if she thinks she's still interested in the man, then I think there should be a whole review of the relationship. Why is the gentleman not getting in touch with her for a whole year? What is blocking him from speaking to somebody that he thinks he loves and wants to, marry a whole year? I think there are a lot of question marks there that the lady should be mindful of. I also want to add that this new gentleman that has surfaced, she shouldn't rush to say no or yes. Because the first one is not clear. And if you rush to say no, who knows? If this will be the angel that coming into your life. So she should be careful. At least can keep some friendship with this new one, not to go too far. And then, like Reverend Derek said, get in touch with the first, if the family got to know about the relationship. But if it was just between the two of you, I don't even see how the family will be in a good position to help. So the long and short is that the first one, she doesn't have much information that we will advise that the information is enough for her to pursue the relationship. She should be careful and perhaps look at the second one and keep praying, not to rush into, concluding on anything.
I think they've answered it so rightly. They hit it so well on the nail. First, get in touch with your, I don't know what to call him, whether your fiancé or your boyfriend. Get in touch with his family. Find out, have they been hearing from him? And that you haven't heard from him in a year. So you don't know whether you are still in a relationship with him or whether you have to move on. And that he not communicating with you for a year, is he indirectly saying that, listen, move on with your life. I have also moved on. So we need to be very, very careful about that. I know a case that happened right here in Royal House Chapel, where the gentleman was outside. The gentleman was outside. The lady had tried so many times to get visas to join the man and wasn't getting. So eventually, she sort of gave up. And the man was also not getting documentation to also come down. And I think there were always arguments and all that. You know, I'm growing. I'm not getting the visas to come. What do I do? Blah, 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 blah. You know, that kind of thing. So because of the arguments, they stopped communicating for a while. The lady met somebody. Unfortunately, got pregnant. When she got pregnant, in her third month, that is when the guy gets papers, comes down, and wants to marry her. I mean, it was her sight. The lady was crying. The gentleman was crying. So we need to be very, very careful, like Reverend Agri is saying, and Reverend Derek is saying, first, get the family involved. Let's be sure that he's moved on. If he's moved on, that is fine. And there'll be nothing wrong in opening up also to the new gentleman, saying that I'd want to move on with you, but this is the thing. I need to hear from the man. I don't want to make a mistake. I want to hear from the man. If I hear from him and he says he's moved on, you know, I'm all yours. So please, the most important thing is to get family involved. And if the guy has friends here, find out from the friends. Have they heard anything? Has he moved on? Is he married? Is he sick? Is he out of job? And because of that, he has refused to come. But whatever it is, for a whole year, if you are in a relationship, I mean, he needs to be communicating with you. So we wish you well. Go ahead, and then let's hear from you what the next move is.
All right, we'll move on to the next one. We are traveling to the Volta region. Says, good evening, Mama Rita.
Good evening.
I am in love with this lady. I really want to marry her. However, she's afraid of marrying me because of my three kids. We are both teachers. I have rightly separated from the mother of my kids, and so there is no form of encumbrance. Mommy, please advise.
Reverend Agree.
Yeah.
Has three kids.
Three kids, 36 years.
36, she's 26.
26.
She loves this lady, but the lady is scared to be stepmother, or, you know, for the ex finally to walk in. So
I think the gentleman should really understand the lady's feelings at this stage, by virtue of her age.
Yeah.
This is a journey she hasn't embarked on before.
Yeah.
It's a fresh one to her, and only for a man who is much older than him to appear with extra baggage. I mean, three kids. She hasn't been a mother before, so these kinds of feelings and uncertainties, they are normal, humanly normal. So she should be allowed to perhaps think about it, seek counsel. She should be allowed to look around what is happening to people within this age bracket who are living with, you know, men with children already. And do her homework and be okay. I don't think the man should mount pressure on her. She should be allowed to, you know. And it's also, is the gentleman saying nobody around with kids already for that? Because somebody with kids coming into your life, I think will come with some level of understanding, already managing children with yours three, to me will be more experienced than 26-year-old person, perhaps right from school and all that. However, counseling can also help. The lady should be allowed to seek counsel and be allowed to pray and think well about it, but not to be forced by the gentleman or even friends or relations of the gentleman at all.
Reverend Derek.
Okay, so of course, I subscribe to what Reverend Agri has said. And then I'm just thinking, you love her, but is it reciprocal? Does she also love you? Marriage is based on love, on trust, on faithfulness, commitment to one another. It's not just a one-sided, you know, issue. So if you love her and you love her genuinely, but it is not reciprocal, then I'm afraid. You don't have much of a chance with her. However, if the love is mutual, then we would want to find out why is the lady not too willing. We know of cases where the man loved the woman, the man had kids, loved the woman loved the man, but the kids were not in favor of the marriage. That should not be ignored. Because if you do, it's going to be a very, very stormy relationship. It's not just about you and the woman. The kids play an integral part in the stability and the success of the marriage. So if she thinks that the kids don't relate to her very well and is the reason why she is developing cold feet or has developed cold feet and is not willing to, you know, come into the relationship, it's quite understandable. So that's the another thing that I want to say. And then finally, if the lady loves the man and the kids are also cool with it, but she's just thinking, you know, I never envisaged when I was growing up, my childhood dream was not to marry a man with kids. I've always wanted somebody, you know, who is just like me. We'll start life together, have our own children. I don't want a situation where it will be your children are fighting our children sort of thing. If that is what she's thinking about, then that also has to be addressed. I have always said that I had some very funny ideas when I was growing up and, you know, when I, even at age 33, when I got married, because I was a virgin, Mama Rita, I wanted to marry a virgin. I didn't want a woman with born one, born two, born three, and that kind of thing. But after 10 years of getting married to the love of my life, a virgin and all, and there was not even a single child in the marriage, I started renewing my mind. Because for every morning for 10 years, you are reminded of your pain of childlessness. When your next door neighbor is calling her kids to wake up from bed, they'll be late to school, you are telling your dogs, get into the cage. And, you know, it was painful. You would go home to this big house, and it's just you and your wife. And Sundays would sometimes be very, very difficult days for us. When you've come to church, and at that time I was the executive pastor at the headquarters, you've dedicated a lot of babies, and you go home, and it's just you and your wife. You know, it's difficult to deal with. It was at that point that I said to myself that, you know, if I were starting all over again, and the woman was coming with two, three kids, I would gladly embrace them. Gladly, wholeheartedly, I would embrace them. I also, you know, had to advise my cousin who had been approached by a divorcee. The man had a child through no fault of his. You know, we heard the story. We sat down, analyzed the whole thing. And I told my cousin that, you know what, years ago, I wouldn't even, the mere fact that he's a divorcee would have been a problem for me. But I'm telling you, this man is a good man, would be a good husband to you. He has one child, you have none, you are a young lady, you know what, go ahead. Today, she always calls me and she's thanking me. So the lady should be, if she needs counseling, she should seek counseling. But from what I have said, if your fear is, you know, this kind of Cinderella, mythical, you know, fairy tale idea of marriage that you've had, we live in a real world. Mm. And in the real world, the situations are different. They are not like the fairy tale thing. So if you love the man, you love the kids, but you are just afraid of going against your fairy tale mentality and so on, I would advise that, you know, you put away those unrealistic expectations and just go ahead. Especially if you've prayed about it and you have peace in your heart, mm-hmm. I'll advise that you go ahead. Thankfully, God has blessed us with, you know, Gideon. And I am so grateful, but I have learned a lesson which I'm sharing with the world now, that if you love the person, he has 2, 3, you know, and you love the kids and you love the man, go ahead. It could be a blessing from God.
Hey, well spoken. So number one, make sure the woman also loves you. If she loves you, then we can take it up from there. But if she doesn't love you and you are forcing, my darling, you enter into the marriage and it will augur well for you. If she loves you, but she's just afraid to mother 3 children at a go, all she does is just to have a bit of counseling and everything will be fine. So if the lady is also listening to us, or you are also in the same situation where you are young, you are 26, 27, 28, well, you've fallen in love with somebody, but the person is a widow or
a divorcee.
A divorcee.
A divorcor.
I didn't say it, Reverend Derek, divorcor. Or entered into a relationship with somebody and it didn't work, you know. He has a baby mama. But then, between the two of you, there's chemistry. You both love each other. I'm thinking that try and get to know the children. I mean, if it will work out well between you and the children, praise God. Like Reverend Derek is saying, some of the things that we refused and rejected and we frowned upon some years back, now in my situation, and from where I sit, I give different counseling than I would have done 20 years ago.
Yeah.
You know, young girl, 25, 26, why would you go into marriage with somebody with 3 children already? But some people naturally love children. If you are the type that naturally love children, get to know the children, let them also fall in love with you, and then it is fine. But for the gentleman, if the lady doesn't love you, don't force it. There are other ladies out there who would not mind mothering 3 children to start with.
All right. Well, there is a follow-up question to this.
Okay.
And says, good evening, counselors. I am Frimpoma, 24 years, and my boyfriend is 33 years with 3 kids. I have no child. I'm willing to marry him. I already love his kids, and we are willing to build our lives together. My parents have always advised that I shouldn't marry someone with a child. But mommy, I love this man, and I go through thick and thin with him. He is also very willing to marry me, but I just have no idea how to break this to my parents. We've been dating for 4 years. He's very responsible towards his kids. Wow. And towards me, what should I do?
So I would advise, get either pastors of your parents or people in society they really, really respect and break the news to them through either the pastors or people they respect, you know, elderly people in the society, and then let them know that it might look like you are disappointing them. You've gone for a man who already has kids, but unfortunately you have fallen in love with him. He also loves you. He's very responsible towards the children, and you think that the children love you and you are ready to murder them. I know it will come as a shock to them. Certainly every mother, every father would want especially her 24-year-old daughter to go into a fresh start, you know, have a fresh man who's never had children, who's never been married. But like we said, and for parents who are listening to me, especially from where we sit and from the kind of cases we handle, you know, now, honestly, if a young lady comes to me and says, mommy, I've met a gentleman, I love him, he has two kids, he has three kids, trust me, I'll ask the lady to go into it. I'm handling a case now where the lady is a pastor's wife, married a virgin. The husband was a virgin when they got married, and they've been married, I think they should be in their 12th year with our children. One day she looked at me and said, mommy, did I make a mistake? Maybe when we were courting, if I had slept with him once
and had the child,
I wouldn't be struggling for a child now. I said, you didn't make a mistake. You are hearing voices, and the voices you are hearing is from the devil. You did the right thing in living in holiness, and God will reward your faithfulness to him. So assuming the gentleman had a child already and the parents said no and she didn't go into it and marry somebody else and she didn't have a child, she would have forever
blame the parents,
regretted. So parents, if you are listening to me, if your daughter thinks she can handle it, she loves the guy loves her, the guy treats her well, she has a relationship with the children, she's getting along well with the children, please, we may never know the future of this girl, and we may never know the future of the girl, the children. Maybe one of these children will be a president or a president's wife.
Yeah,
we don't know.
We
always hear the story of Bill Clinton. The Clinton is not his real name.
Ooh.
The Clinton is the name of his stepfather. If the stepfather had rejected him, and had rejected the mother, he wouldn't be the father of a president or an ex-president.
That's right. That's
so
right.
We may never
That's
know the future
right.
of these children.
That's
we've heard such stories so many times. Joseph wasn't the real biological child father
That's
of
right.
Jesus.
Yeah.
But when we are tracing the family tree of Jesus, we see the name Joseph in.
That's right.
So we may never ever know the future.
That's right.
They want it. You have a daughter who is 24, 25, and she thinks that this is what I want. I've met a man I love. Yes, he's married before, or he has children, but I think that my future with him will be good. Let's counsel them well. If within the counseling we see that yes, she can manage it and the man can handle her well, why not? Let's add our blessings to it and then let's move on. And before we go on, in the Catholic Church, a colleague of mine met an elderly man. It was about 15 years difference. And the Catholic father spoke, was so much against it. Why would you go for somebody 15 years difference? I mean, but the man had never been married. The lady said, oh, he's the one I've met and I've fallen in love with him. And I think he will treat me well, you know, blah, 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 blah. Back forth. The Catholic father accepted and the parents also accepted and they got married. Years down the line, her sisters never got married.
Wow.
So it means that if she had missed this man, maybe she would never have been married. She would never have been married. So sometimes, as parents, as guidance, as counselors, as pastors, we need to be very careful the kind of counseling we give to people when they come to us. Let's not always be in a hurry to say no.
Yeah.
I mean, this is not the norm. Young girl, why would you? We may never know the future for these people.
That's
so
right.
Please, and you should see the children they've had. Beautiful, handsome children. Beautiful, handsome children. Beautiful, handsome children. So we will take one more question and then we will go for a break, but let your questions come in.
Mommy, can I
add something small to this? So as parents, we do love our children and we want the best for them. So apart from Gideon, I have an adopted daughter, Mama Madeleine, who is 35 years old. We love them like our, we love her like our own biological, daughter, and we want the best for her. Every good parent does. Bible says, "Can a woman stand that care sees towards the child she bears?" It's you love your kids, and sometimes with the best of intentions, you may give them a counsel like, "Don't marry a man who has kids." Maybe you are saying it based on experience, things that you have seen. And so you are right. However, someone said this, so let me put it out there. Anything good without God amounts to zero. You may be giving good counsel, but is it godly counsel? So yes, you love your daughter, you want the best for her, you are giving her good counsel, but is it godly counsel? In other words, what does God also have to say about the situation? And the example that comes to mind is that of Samson. The Bible says that he fell in love, as an Israelite young man, fell in love with a Philistine. And in those days, it was a taboo for an Israelite to marry outside the tribe. So their parents, with the best of intentions, wanting the best for their son, were opposing it. But the very next verse says that they did not know that it was of the Lord. So they were actually opposing something that was of the Lord, with very good intentions. So we need to be very, very careful. If you love your children, the best you can do is to pray for them. Because maybe what you are opposing is actually God's best for them. Like Mama Rita was sharing, I shared two stories already.
That's right.
In that direction. So parents, let us learn. Let's try not to be God in the lives of our kids. Let's give them the guidance, but above all, the best we can do for them is to pray for them, wish them well, and pray that the journey they are embarking on would end up well for them.
There's a related comment or question to what we've just discussed. It says, Mama Rita, I am 32 and he is 42. He has two children. We want to marry, but I am scared also. The children are my problem, she says. He loves his kids so much, sometimes it scares me. Our children may never get that kind of love needed from a father. This is my worry.
Well, at 32, trust me, you don't have too much time. So you shouldn't be scared. a man that loves his children, if he has a child with you, would also love your children. I mean, he's a very responsible father. You can see that. And then number two, you also fall in love with the children. Once you fall in love with the children, the father would automatically fall in love with you. Mm. When I met my husband, I just realized that he loves God. He loves Jesus. Everything about him is God, and everything about him is Jesus. And I knew that if I wanted his attention, and if I wanted him to really love me, I must fall in love with his God. Mm. I must have an encounter with his Jesus. And I did. And it was so automatic.
That's
so
right.
Number one, it doesn't just come. Build a relationship with the children. Start. Now that you are not married to him, build the relationship. Start talking about your future with him. Hey, so our children, you know, talk about it. Whatever your fears are, it will come out. And for a thing like this, he has two children, you are scared. Start counseling, marriage counseling. Sometimes a lot of the issues will come out during the marriage counseling. If he would treat you well and he would treat your children well, you would know through the counseling. But trust me, any man that loves his children would also fall in love with the children you will have in the marriage. And the problem would be, unless you are saying that you also have your children you are going into the marriage with, and you are scared if you fall in love with your children. But if you don't have children and you are thinking about the children you'll be having with him, I want you to know that, you know, it's going to be very, very automatic. And I don't know where their mother is. Maybe he's been a single father. He's taking care of the children, you know, right from the beginning. And if that is the case, it means that he's playing two roles. He's being the father and he's being the mother. Certainly, if he's the father and he's the mother, there'll be that bonding and attachment with his children. And don't go into the relationship trying to break the bonding with his children.
Yeah,
don't.
Yeah.
Instead of it, also fall in love with the children.
That's
and
right.
Trust me, once you equally love the children, he would love you back. And then the children you will have in the marriage, he would also equally love them. I don't know if you would have something
yes,
to...
Yes, Mommy, I think well noted. I mean, you've really said a lot. The letter I want to put here is that those ladies who are looking at men with 2, 3, or 4 children, or from what Mommy has said and my colleague, Reverend Minister, has said, it means that you need to do a lot of work.
Yes.
You have to patiently look into the whole thing, because you are now studying the man, his relationship with the children, and perhaps what really resulted in their mother separating from the father. Is the mother of the kids still alive? What resulted in that? What caused the separation? Are you convinced the cause of the separation, that it wasn't the fault of the man? I mean, you need help. Please, you need help. And like Mommy is saying, counseling will help you. Take your time. Don't just say because he loves you, you want to just ignore your the advice from your parents or from elders around and all that, and then just stick to the man because he says he loves you. A lot of things will only surface when you finally get into the institution called marriage. There are many things that you may not see before the marriage comes, you know, into existence. There are things that will only surface when you get into the marriage institution. So it will help you to really understand what it means to marry somebody with kids already, Is the man also ready to raise fresh kids with you? How many are you expecting to have, or do you desire to have in the marriage? Is he ready to respond to that? All these things, when you go through counseling, you will be helped to, you know, position yourself where, like Mommy is saying. So take notes and don't rush.
I think we'll go on a break.
Yes, we'll go for a quick break. We shall be back to address all your concerns, questions. Keep them coming, +233 200 515253. Family Life Series, building stable and happy homes.
Another Christmas is here with us again. Christmas is a season of love. In Royal House Chapel, we are noted for showing love. We show love to our senior citizens. We show love to School of Restoration. School of Restoration is a group for ex-convicts, drug addicts, prostitutes, and their like. We are going to orphanages, going to visit them and show them love. Christmas, this is what Christmas is all about. If you are a believer and you claim you follow Jesus, and during Christmas you will chew chicken, drink malt, and not think about your neighbor, I don't think you are Christian enough. This Christmas, let us show love to underprivileged.
My name is Irama Agri, one of the directors of Grand Pacific Limited. A few years ago, our mother, Mama Rita, shared her vision with us concerning building City of Shiloh. One of her intentions towards the vision is to reach out and give assistance to the vulnerable, victims of abuse, and the neglected in society. I believe in this vision. That is why Psalm 37 verse 25 says, I have been young and now I am old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging for bread. And I say this, that I have seen, I have heard, and I'm experiencing what God can do to anyone that supports the kingdom business. I am a proud supporter of City of Shiloh.
The Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 3 verse 1, and in those days there was no widespread revelation and the word of the Lord was rare. Such a poor testimony and a poor testament. And this is something we don't want to be said of our generation. If you are looking for an outlet of the word of God, you are looking for a place of prayer, you are looking for a place of sharp prophecy, we are combining everything for you in one program called Heal Our Land. This and every Thursday at 7 p.m. on Powerline Television. I'll be your host. My name is Pastor Papa Crunchy Ankara, and I'll be here with seasoned men and women of God that will be coming with sharp revelation to divide the word of God for us. You don't want to miss any week of this program. It's going to be powerful. It's on Powerline Television, power to transform lives.
All right, welcome back. Family Life Series, the Ask Mama Rita session. Get engaged in the conversation across all social media platforms with the hashtag A-S-K-M-A-M-A-R-I-T-A. Well, for all youth across the nation, I am here to announce to you and remind you of our upcoming National All Nights. Time to say thank you with the Apostle General himself, coming to share the mind of God with us, prepare us for the year 2022, and give us the theme for next year's camp. I trust that you don't want to miss this. The Apostle General is waiting for us on Friday here at Ahimfie, 9 p.m. sharp. You want to make your way here. There are a lot of our assemblies who are busing themselves here. So if you are outside, you are a follower, a viewer on Powerline TV, and you want to be part of this all-night prayer celebration with Apostle General, you can walk to our nearest assembly, and they would gladly welcome and come here with you. You may also call our contacts, and we'll assist you accordingly. Our students across all our various campuses, we know you're on vacation, you are chilling, you are preparing for the Christmas with your chicken, freezing in the deep freezer. Well, come and let's pray and create room for that chicken. We'll be seeing you come Friday, 9 p.m. sharp with the Apostle General. And last Friday, Mommy, it was awesome, awesome. Last Friday with the women, amazing. Prayer atmosphere and the testimonies.
Oh, the testimonies.
The time of testimony. It was quite. If you missed it, well, it's still online. You can go back and watch on Facebook, Mama Rita K, and watch exactly what the Lord has done for the women and how they express themselves in saying thank you to God. Well, the youth are going to do it this
Pastor
Friday.
Pastor Jifape, I'm not missing.
Yes, Mommy.
For all the rice in China.
Yay.
I am coming. I'll be here.
Mama Rita is there.
I will come and thank God. I haven't finished thanking God.
Hey.
I miss the men. I was there at the women. I'm not missing the youth.
Movers and shakers.
Movers and shakers. We are coming to move and shake things.
Amazing.
On Friday.
Amazing.
Please make a date with us. Coming Friday with Apostle General. All the movers and the shakers will be here.
And Mama Rita will be here as
well. I'll be here.
All right, Mommy, the next question is a heavyweight.
Hey.
Very straight to the point.
Hey, no, that's why I have seniors here to answer.
So he says, good evening. I am married with 4 children for the past 17 years.
Okay.
But I'm not interested in my husband anymore.
Oh, my God.
He lost his job just before we got married. So he tells us 17 years ago. It seems he's very relaxed about finding a job. I have been working hard to feed and take care of the family for us to get better always. But Mommy, he's just so relaxed, nothing bothers him. I don't love him anymore. Please advise. 17 years.
17 years.
The love and the interest is gone.
My darling, let's take it the other way around. Assuming you were the one who lost your job and you have tried and you are not getting any, would you expect him to do the same thing to you? What women do not know is that every man has an ego. Every man has some amount of pride. Trust me, there is no man who would want to be cheap enough, sit down and let a woman feed him. No. So far, I haven't met any. Maybe he has tried, but you do not know. But this is what I always advise men. If you are not working, and the woman is the one working, take up some of the responsibilities of her house. If you don't know how to cook, learn how to cook. That by the time she comes, at least there's food on the table. I don't think she'll complain. You should be the one to take the children to school.
That's right.
And pick them up from school.
That's right.
You should help with tidying up of the home. If by the time she comes and the bedroom is neat, the hall is neat, the kitchen is neat, I don't think that she will be complaining. Yes, it's possible that she might have fallen out of love with you. Why? Because she's too stressed up. She's the one waking up very early in the morning, seeing to the children, cooking, going to the market, doing everything, checking children's homework, going for PTA meetings. And she's the same person bringing income home.
Yeah.
Certainly she would complain. It would be very difficult from where I sit to really say whether you didn't say the other side of it. Is he helping at home? If he's helping, praise God. Then at least have a father figure in the home. And what women do not know is that when there's a father figure in the home, it brings a check on the children. The children can't misbehave. Like I said from the beginning, let's see it the other way around. Assuming it was you, what would you say? Would you be happy if the man came one day and said, you're a lazy woman, you're a useless woman, I am the one paying all utilities in the house, utility bills in the house, I'm the one paying school fees, I am the one putting food on the table, because you are useless and you don't want to work and you are not getting a job, I don't love you anymore and I want to divorce you. See the other way around. You are men. I don't know. I don't know how, if it's very, very true that some men are so lazy. You see, what a woman can do, unfortunately, men can't do. When we got married and I had my children, I started having nanakos. I realized that where I was working, the take home couldn't take me home. So I had to resign, and there was nobody to take care of my daughter. I couldn't afford a nanny. So I had to resign to be at home to take care of her. But what I did was that when I was at home, I started cooking fancy kinky, leaving for my grandmother to sell, and then started going to the Tuesday market and started selling what we call tolo beef. Beef, salted beef, started selling it. It's very difficult for men to do these kind of jobs. But is the man also saying that for 17 years,
couldn't buy and sell anything?
He can't, I don't know. Maybe you'll be able to, for 17 years, maybe the kind of jobs he's looking for.
Yeah.
He's looking for white collar jobs. He's expecting a job in the bank, and nothing is coming. Is there anything else he can do?
Yeah.
Is he educated? Can he start like private classes, teaching children at home? What is it that men can do, you know, whilst you are waiting to have a job?
Mommy, I think the lady didn't actually help by letting us know when she started feeling uncomfortable and losing her love. For 17 years with four kids. It's obviously an indication that there are certain factors that have really
kept
sustained
them together.
So when did she actually begin feeling this uncomfortable, you know? One thing I think men should always realize, when you look at the reason for marriage coming into existence, God, you know, bringing the marriage institution into existence, Adam was in the garden struggling alone, battling left, right, without even realizing that he needed help. So God himself decided to come in to bring him a helper. And when you look at the way God presented the helper, you can deduce that God brought an expert helper. So if you, the man, you have this at the back of your mind once in a marriage that you, God has given you somebody who can really help you to achieve whatever God expects you to achieve, you will handle the woman very well.
Yeah.
And God will always endorse your effort.
Mm.
If you have lost your job, certainly you haven't, I don't think you've lost your relationship with your maker.
Yeah.
And you haven't lost your love for God. Even if your love for God and for your marriage is dwindling, you still can do something about that. In the home, you need to understand that you are God's designated leader of the marriage, of the family, of the, you know, everything. And certainly God will always hold you responsible for whatever happens to the family, especially the kids and all that. If you realize all this, you must then seek help. If you think you are lacking in any area, why will you sit down for your wife to carry all the burden when you are the leader and you are expected to be responsible for the upkeep of the family? If you don't have money, I don't think you've lost your heart and your love and your spirit. I mean, something, there are a lot of things you can give to the wife and the family that you don't need money to buy.
Yeah.
Encouragement. Be there for her.
Yeah.
If she is struggling, doing all the things like mommy said, out there to bring in money, there are other areas that certainly you don't need money to buy. By the way, what is keeping you in the house? There are a lot of things that these days we see even bank managers who lost their jobs and are now driving Uber and things like that. People are doing anything to sustain their lives and keep their families because of the love they have for their families. If you really love your family, you will certainly sacrifice. And sacrifice entails a lot if you really love them. So you have no excuse to run away from your responsibilities. And I don't think you should sit down for your wife to leave you and then perhaps take the kids away or dump the children on you and then run away. You won't be able to bear the consequences. It's rather spend some energy to put the house in order. Your wife is not asking you for plenty money. I think she's just asking for your attention, your heart, your love, your care, your commitment. And these things are there. She will understand and perhaps encourage you to do more in the house. So men ought to understand it this way. We are responsible, whichever angle you look at the whole matter, we are responsible for the leadership of,
So Reverend Agri, you are saying that now even bank managers are driving Uber. So if they are driving Uber, then it means that even if you don't know how to drive, go and learn how to drive.
Mama, I'm even citing this as, just as an example. I am constructing a building somewhere. Recently, I saw two guys, you know, among the laborers. I realized they look a bit different from the other laborers. So in a conversation with them, they are graduates.
Wow.
Graduates. And they are getting at least 80 CDs per day.
Per day.
So with the energy they have, they think they should do something whilst, you know, they wait for whatever they are desiring to, you know. And these are, I mean, we see.
And I realize that even the security companies, you know, you don't actually need a certificate to work in the security company.
You need discipline.
So maybe the woman also has a case.
Yeah.
And that if you are making the move, you will not be able to cook fancy kenke like I did. You will not be able to go and sell at the Tuesday market like I did. But you could go and carry concrete.
Exactly.
And business is still, pardon?
Exactly.
Momo business is still there. I mean, that's there are little things. Reverend Agri, you mentioned one I've even forgotten, apart from the Uber. There are other jobs that men can, that are available. Security. Now, there are security companies all over that you can work as a security man. You can also fill in station jobs.
That's right.
People are saying no jobs.
There are jobs.
What they describe as jobs.
Kind of job
is the kind of job they are looking for. So start from somewhere.
Want, at least go with what you get.
That is it.
And then once you
that
wait
is
for,
it. Exactly. That is it. Exactly. So this is what we are encouraging,
exactly,
especially the young graduates who are out of school that are waiting for jobs. Your dream job hasn't come. But whilst it hasn't come, do something. Don't sit down. I always tell people, I have never sat down one day not doing anything. Even as a student, during holidays, I would do vacation employment. By the time school opens, I have enough money. My parents top up for me, and I am there. Out of school, I started working. When I started having, I had my first child, and I couldn't work anymore. I mean, office work. I couldn't work anymore. I started selling, you know, Fanti Kenke. People laughed, but that was their business. Sometimes we are looking at what people will say. And the impressions people will have about us, my darling, it's tomorrow that matters, not today.
That's right.
I went to sell the beef.
That's right.
And I sold the Fanti Kenke.
Mm.
And people thought that I was a disgrace.
Mm.
At the same place that they thought I had disgraced myself,
mm,
at that same place, they saw me in my bank uniform, with my bank bus.
Mm.
So the uniform, they know that I didn't just go and sew anything and wear to pretend I was working in the bank. They saw bank bus pick me up and drop me, pick me up in the morning. And what I did, Reverend Agri, I will make sure that I won't leave home. I'll stand at my gate for the bus to wait for me at the junction, blow
the horn, ping, 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 ping.
And then I'll move up. I mean, so people who thought I was a disgrace, my darling, don't look at anybody. You have no excuse for sitting at home for 17 years. You can start something. And what I've discovered, that whilst you are doing something, God opens bigger doors for you.
Exactly.
When you are at home, you don't even hear when things happen.
Exactly.
But once you do something,
that's
there was
right.
Somebody I met, you know, at a filling station who was serving so well. And I discovered that, hey, this guy speaks very good English.
Mm.
So I asked, so why are you here? What's your level? You know, he said, oh, I went to this school, very good secondary school, university. The results was good. So I said, why are you here? No job. I said, you know what? When you see the cars, the big cars, they were 4x4, and you serve them, tell them, I'm looking for a job. I went there one day, I didn't meet the guy. Much later, I met him in town. He said he has a job.
Praise
He's
God.
Working in one of the financial institutions.
Wow.
There was Faith, who came to work with us as security.
As security.
I went out with Faith one day, heard his English, and I said, no, this one is not security. You know, grammar. So we began to chat. He said, I went to Mawuli Secondary School. I said, so what are you doing? Number one, there's nobody to help pay my school fees. Number two, I tried and I never got admission. So I went into it. Eventually, he got University of Ghana. Went to school, Legon for 4 years. Today, he's our chief security. My darling, don't sit at home. Start from somewhere. Humble yourself. Start from somewhere. And once you start, you'll be shocked
that
out of it, God will open a bigger door for you to enter.
Exactly.
I'm sure if I hadn't started the Fanti Kenke, and I hadn't started, I didn't humble myself to be in the Tuesday market, God wouldn't have opened the door for me to work in the bank. Today, I won't be premier lady of a whole church or whole organization. I'm sure all those process, God was taking me through it so that when people come to me with that kind of situations, I would understand and help them. If you have never been through it and people come, you always think they are lying, they are pretending, they are lazy, they don't want to get a job. But because I had gone through it, today I'm able to help them. Younger ones that are coming, please, you can't sit at home for 17 years.
No
go
way.
And look for
That's
security
right.
job.
That's
go
right.
and do something.
That's right.
At least, even if you are not taking 1,000 Ghana home, but at the end of the month, you are even taking 200, and your wife is seeing that you are trying, he won't complain.
Exactly.
He leaves in the morning, you are sleeping.
Mm.
She comes back, you are watching television.
Mm.
And she's the same one who is going to the kitchen to cook and everything. Oh, my God. She will certainly complain.
Just
a quick one. Mm. Since the lady didn't tell us when exactly all these things started, assuming in the beginning that guy was performing well, doing well and all that, then lost the job. And I think a piece of advice for her is that she should not be, you know, abusing him verbally because he's in the house and all that.
For him to lose his confidence.
Yes, if the situation is too much on you, you can speak to your pastor or any senior person that you trust to call your husband and help him. Personally, I've helped some fathers and husbands who didn't know what they were, didn't know that what they were doing was actually harming or hurting the wives.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, with time, I mean, I spent some time with them and gave them counsel, and things are well now. The wives are happy.
So, Reverend Agri, another case I handled, when the lady came to me to complain, and my husband is lazy, he's not looking for a job, blah, blah, blah. I said, when you got married, was he working? When you met him, was he working?
Mm-hmm.
She said, yes, he was working.
Mm.
And I said, after you married, was he working? He said he was working. When he was working, was he responsible? He said, mommy, he was responsible. I said, then what went wrong?
Mm.
Said, he just stopped the work. The lady didn't know that the gentleman was actually going through depression.
Mm.
Didn't know that the gentleman was actually going through a depression.
Serious.
So sometimes we need to look back. If he was lazy from day one, you have a case. But if he wasn't lazy, he worked, he was responsible, and something went wrong, let's find out. That is why counseling is very important. If you belong to a church, take him to your pastor. You know, let's go into it and find out. Is he just lazy? Is he just not looking for a job? Is he just too comfortable because you are feeding him? Or something might be happening to him psychologically.
Can I add a little to it? And I'll pick it from a scripture that just flashed through my mind. This kind goeth not out but by fasting and prayer.
I
am not given to superstition, but having been a pastor for many years, you've also heard things that makes you, you know, want to look at situations like this, sometimes from the spiritual angle. And one thing the lady said, which caught my attention, was that he is not motivated. I mean, I say, he is happy the way he is. This, as soon as I Pastor Chivape read that, what came to my mind was a story or a colleague of mine's story. We were both at Trinity Theological Seminary, studied for our first degree. We made first class. So he was intelligent, very sharp. We went on to do our master's degree. In 2 years, I was done. And this guy, 4 years down the line, he had not completed his course.
After first class.
After first class student, brilliant, intelligent. So the professor, his professor, who was also my professor, got worried. He said, Derek, I want you to talk to your friend because I don't get it. I've called him. It's not normal.
It's not normal.
I have called him. I have had counseling sessions with him. What is it? And he doesn't seem to be able to pinpoint exactly what is wrong. So I also engaged him in conversation. And I couldn't point my finger on exactly what his problem was. He said, do you know that, you know, you've taken 4 years at this game? And he said, yes, I don't know. Reverend Derek, I don't know. Then I said, you know what? Let's just fast and pray.
Wow.
Mommy, we embarked on a 3-day fast. On the third day, God visited him. He had a revelation through a dream. In the dream, according to him, he was sitting in front of a jury. And they were all members of his family.
Wow.
And they were saying that in our family, nobody goes to the university. You went to the university, made the first class. You wouldn't sit down. You decided to go and get a second degree, master's degree, to rub it in our face. Jesus. It was at that time that we decided to arise.
Wow.
And lock you in prison.
Wow.
So, and when he appeared before them, he saw himself in prison garments.
Wow.
And he said that they told him that in these 4 years, we have kept you in jail. That is why you've never been able to progress academically.
Wow.
But the 4-year jail sentence we gave you is almost over. And if we don't do anything, you will complete your course. So we are going to sentence you to prison for another 5 years.
Wow.
And then he woke up. When he woke up, he was shaking like this. He called me. He said, Reverend Derek, this is the dream I have had. I said, it is not just an ordinary dream.
It's not just an ordinary dream.
That's right.
So together, we prayed.
You battled it.
I hope somebody's
listening.
This kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. We prayed. We broke the power of the enemy. Lift up your head, O ye gates, and ye ancient gates, be lifted up so that the King of glory, the glory of God upon my friend, can come in. Any principal, we prayed. I brought him to Royal House Chapel.
Praise God.
We prayed on the altar. I told him, put a sacrifice on the altar. Mama Rita, what he had not been able to do in 4 years, after that prayer and that deliverance, in 1 month, he completed his...
Jesus!
1 month, I am not telling lies.
Jesus!
That's great.
This kind does not go out. Praise he God. Didn't know what was happening to
him.
He was just not motivated. Mm.
This could be the man's
problem. Yes.
From the 10th to the 30th
this could
January,
be the man's problem.
In Royal House Chapel, we have something we called Week of the Altar, where we bring our needs and our requests before God at the altar. We fast 21 days, and there's been diverse testimonies. Please, if you are with somebody, and like the woman shared, the person is not motivated. You don't know what is happening to the person. You met the person, he wasn't like that, she wasn't like that. All of a sudden, I mean, look at what we are hearing. Somebody who made the first class.
First class, brilliant student.
He's brilliant. After first class, for me, I always say that my first degree was more difficult than my second degree.
That's right.
So if I've been able to pass my first degree,
the second degree
must be cocoa for me.
That's
so
right.
If the person is not passing second degree, then it means that there's something. My darling, rise up.
The enemy is not looking for people who are failing.
I like that. Reverend Agri, you are saying something.
And robbers don't attack Zoom Lion truck carrying rubbish. They will attract a bullion bank that is carrying something.
You people are saying something.
So if you become...
You said they don't follow what?
They don't
Zoom Lion.
That is carrying
rubbish.
They are not interested.
They are not interested. They don't get anything.
So please,
they will
if
attack
you're
a bullion bank.
Or you are a husband and you've been sleeping, wake up from the 10th to the 30th of January, year 2022.
Jesus, I can't wait.
We are coming together, we are fasting, we are praying, we are breaking chains.
Well,
thank God for mates like you.
Oh, yes.
He would have been locked up another 4 years.
I am telling you. And he may not probably have even graduated. Because after a while, you know.
And this is why people even cause suicide.
Exactly.
Because you wonder what it, they get frustrated.
Get frustrated. Tired, you know. Because they themselves, they don't know what is wrong with them.
Imagine if he has a spouse who also doesn't understand.
Who doesn't understand.
Exactly. Oh,
it complicates then
it becomes.
Well, that's why from
exactly.
Grace is here with Mama Rita and his seasoned counselors addressing such needs, helping build homes that are struggling, helping solve solutions that are getting people depressed. And I know some of you have sent several questions. By answering one question, I'm confident that a lot more questions have actually been addressed.
Yeah.
And Mama Rita spoke about Week of the Altar. Well, before Week of
Yeah. You want to come 8 p.m. sharp here at Royal House Chapel, happening at the Oil Room, with God's servant himself, the Apostle General, prophet for our generation. Ladies and gentlemen, he has a word in his mouth concerning what to expect 2022. Don't miss it.
Amen. We'll go to our next question, Mama Rita. Says, good evening, Mama Rita.
Good evening.
Please, I am married for 13 years with 5 children. My husband is a pastor and a medical doctor. He had an affair and gave birth with one of his clients, whom he was going to see at home. Mom, I saw this coming and I warned him severally to stop going to the lady's house, but he wouldn't listen until the issue happened. The lady once insulted me and wrote my husband's name in her antenatal card that he was rather her husband. He's begged me for forgiveness. I know I have, but I cry every day out of the pain because I warned him. At times, my flesh really wants to leave him, but I keep going. Please advise me. I'm losing it.
Wow. Reverend Derek.
Wow. Wow.
Married to a pastor, not just a pastor, a medical doctor. Who is supposed to know
better.
Some way, somehow. He got himself trapped, had a child with another woman.
Well, let me speak to every married man. The day I read in my Bible, or in the Bible, that David, a man after God's own heart, committed adultery with Bathsheba, and in trying to cover up his sin, moved a step further, committed murder and blah, 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 and so on, I discovered that this kind of sin is not beyond anybody. If you don't take the necessary precautions, you can be a man or a woman for that matter after God's own heart, and yet you fall heavily like Humpty Dumpty fell. And sometimes putting the broken pieces back together can be a Herculean task. It can be difficult, especially when trust is broken. So let us understand that there is no one. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 6 that you cannot put fire in your bosom and say that it will not burn you. You cannot walk on hot coals and say your feet will not be blistered. Sometimes when you are walking into danger, you do not see. But if your wife or your partner is warning you and telling you that I'm not comfortable with the kind of conversations you have with these your daughters in the Lord. I'm not comfortable with the way you call them. You call me honey and you call them honey. So what's the difference?
That's right.
You call me darling and you are calling them darling, sweetheart, and so on. So what's the difference between me and them? You know, death and life is in the power of the tongue. So we really need to be very careful. Sometimes as men, we genuinely don't see the dangers coming. We feel that it is just normal. And I do recall many years ago, Mommy, how Mama Della told me that, this, your daughter in the Lord, I don't like, you know, the way she behaves around you. I told her, oh, Della, you and your melancholy attitude and blah, blah, blah. You're not, I mean, this woman.
I feel.
you know, nothing. I don't think that she is a danger in any way. In any case, I don't feel attracted to her. So what is your problem? I'm glad I listened to my wife.
Wow.
Mama Rita, one day she came to my office, you know, to discuss a problem with me. And then this was when I was here at the headquarters. And other people came in, other daughters in the Lord, and then she was give them attitude. So when they left, I said, what exactly is your problem? But they shouldn't be coming here when I'm here with you. I said, hey, why? Why shouldn't they be coming here?
She owns you.
And then I just asked her, Anyebia. Are you beginning to fall in love with this man? Mm-hmm. Then her response shocked me. Something like that.
Hey.
So quickly. The next office was Reverend Johnny's office. Mm-hmm. I ran to Reverend Johnny's office and I said, Reverend Johnny, there is fire in Soweto.
Come and save me or quench the fire.
I said, Reverend Johnny, I have a problem on my hands. Mm. And then I narrated what had happened to him. And I said, she says she has a problem. She wants to come and discuss with me. I'm going to tell her that you are better at handling this kind of problems than I am. Then I'll push her to you.
That's right.
And handle her for me. Because at least the way she's feeling towards me, she's not feeling towards that way towards you. And Mama Tela has been warning me and I wasn't seen. So Reverend Johnny graciously embraced the challenge, dealt with her, and that was my escape route.
Wow.
So sometimes you may not see, but that's what your wife is seeing, it's not a farrago of baseless fantasies.
Punch it.
She is seeing something that you are not seeing, and it's not imaginary. It can be very real.
That's right.
And it is a wise man who would listen to the counsel of a caring husband, a caring wife, and not think that she's being insecure. That's Why is she being insecure? She's seeing something you are not seeing. Yeah. And like the wife said, I kept warning him. I saw this coming. The red flags were all there. The signs were all written on the wall, but he wouldn't listen. Of course, when it gets to a point when you yourself, you're falling in love, even when you see. So it reminds me of something. Delilah said, tell me the secret of your strength and how I may destroy you, how you can be destroyed. And the guy, the woman didn't hide his agenda, but Samson was so much in love, infatuated, so captivated. And the Savior ended up needing salvation. So let's listen to our wives when they talk. And women, let's listen to our husbands when they talk and they warn us. Yeah. Having said that, now that there has been a breach of trust, it's not easy. Forgiving somebody is not the same as being able to rebuild the trust. Forgiveness can be done immediately, instantaneously, but to rebuild the trust will take a long time. So the man must understand this, and he must try and work out his own salvation. In other words, let me not be too scriptural. He must try and earn that trust that, you know, he has lost with his wife. And of course, it means being more transparent with her, you know, being more prayerful. The family that prays together stays together. And we become close to the person we pray to, that is God, the person we pray for, and the person we pray with. I can guarantee you cannot never underestimate the power of prayer when it comes to these things. And the woman, it's natural to feel the way you are feeling. It's very, very natural.
Especially if they don't have a child yet, and this extra
has produced a child. You know, it will heighten her insecurities. At what point are you going to leave me? Because he is your child. And at what point are you going to leave me? It's difficult. But I would say that since the man has come back to you and is begging for your forgiveness and all, the best thing the two of you can do is to go together and see, you know, a seasoned marriage counselor. And I would recommend my mother, Mama Rita, to you. 21 years ago, she counseled my wife and I, and we are forever grateful to you, Mommy and Apostle General. Certain things you shared with us, we have practiced them, and it has made our marriage very, very, very solid. So I would recommend Mama Rita very, very highly. And it's just a privilege that we are sitting down here. We are not co-equals
at all.
So it's just a privilege that we are sitting down here, you know, on her show, and we are also counseling. But I highly recommend that you come and see her as a couple and, you know, have a one-on-one with Mama Rita. And I can guarantee you, by the time you are done, you would be on your way to restoration. Amen.
Amen. Reverend Agri, I don't know if you want to.
I think Reverend Derek has really touched on. The little I will add here is that this teaches all men that the women in our lives are indeed God sent, God given helpers. And within the help is our protection. So when your wife is drawing your attention to something she's not too okay with, don't ignore the signals. If at least you don't even understand her, ask the Holy Spirit to explain. Because God will not plant a woman in your life to come and damage you. The woman has been planted in your life for your own safety, for your own security. The little I will also say to our lady is that it has already happened. And you can't reverse it. A human being has been born. Let's thank God for the life of the baby. Your husband has come to apologize. The rest is now within you to forgive yourself and be okay. Try hard. And like Reverend Derek said, if it's still a struggle, you can't overcome, seek help. At the end of the day, time will tell. Very soon you see that all will be okay. The other thing you need to understand is that the other lady will never have anybody's support in your husband's life. You are the only one that has been endorsed, legally recognized, and you are the only wife. So as far as you are concerned, that lady has no support. So don't worry yourself thinking about her and this, and all you need to do is just pray for her. Because if she knew what she was doing, she wouldn't have started it at all. She has really harmed herself, and she also needs God's forgiveness. So don't worry much about her and the interferences and all that. Seek the help of the Holy Spirit. Love your husband, love the newborn child, and just be in your lane and do your play your role as a wife. Forget about all those things. The Lord himself will take care of the rest.
Amen.
So I think they've said it all. They've spoken to the men. Reverend Agri has spoken to the women, but I want to add on to speaking to the women. The mistake has already been done. I know it's difficult, like Reverend Derek said, it's difficult to forgive and let go. But don't make matters worse for your husband. It's one mistake women do all the time. Always referring. I told you, and you didn't listen. I told you, and you didn't listen. I told you, please, he's learned his lesson, trust me.
That's right.
He's learned his lesson. There was one time somebody came coming to borrow money from my husband. So my husband, as he is, will not hide it from me, so told me. And I said, you know what? Let me pray about it. I don't feel lucky in my spirit. Let me pray about it. Oh, by the third day, I hadn't finished praying about it. He came back and said, oh, he's giving the money to the gentleman. I said, ah, but I told you. He said, oh, the way the man was pestering me. And I mean, you should hear the man's company doing very well. When we gave him the money, he didn't pay. Huge sum of money.
Wow.
Money we had saved for years for our first daughter's school fees. Wow. He didn't pay. And stop the church.
Wow.
But one thing the Holy Ghost taught me that I should never refer. I should never hit him in the face. I told you, I never said it. He came back and he apologized. And he said, I should have listened to you. Since then, this one has become a learning curve. Anytime he says something, and I say, let me pray about it. He will wait for me to finish praying and for me to say, oh, we can do it, or let's wait.
Okay.
You know, they learn from their mistakes. So please don't be referring him all the time. And don't be crying and making things very difficult for him. Make the home lively. Yes, you are hurt, but make the home lively. Let him know that you are still the wife that he married. Make everything okay as though nothing has happened. Trust me, he's learned, he will forever be with you. Number two, if the opportunity comes and he says, I want to go for my child. I want to bring all my children under one roof. If the woman is ready to give away the child, please, that child is yours. Unless the woman is not ready to give away the child.
That's right.
But if the woman is ready to give away the child, please, a child of your husband is yours. Go for that child. I advise people like that. I said, the man is ready to go for the child. Take the child and mother the child. They didn't listen to me. And certainly where the child is, he would want to go and visit. When the child is sick, he would want to go and see. Once a while, he would sleep overnight because the child has temperature. By the time some of the women realized, the man had a second and had a third. As for this one, I told them, I told you so. So my darling, if you have the opportunity, unless the woman doesn't want to give the child out, if the man wants to bring the child to you, collect it. Number two, if the woman is keeping the child, be a good Christian. You said you're a pastor's wife. Every month, find out, have you taken some money to the woman? Have you sent her some money? Have you sent her some groceries? Have you paid school fees? Please, be a Christian woman. Why? Because the child is innocent.
Yeah.
Don't punish the child for the mistakes of the father and That's the mistakes right. of the mother.
Yeah.
Please, take good care of the child. Once a while, when you go to town and you know the boy's or the girl's age, and you see a dress, buy. You see a toy, buy. Give it to your husband. Say, go and give it to my son or go and give it to my daughter. My darling, you will win his favor forever.
Yes.
Do it. I taught certain women, they didn't listen, but I hope you will listen.
Amen.
God bless you. And remember, nobody knows the future of a king.
That child.
You may never know what the child will become tomorrow. I think we can take a few.
Well, we probably may be able to take two more questions.
Yeah. And then. So maybe next week we will add question time to
very much
the testimonies and all that. Otherwise, we will not be able to finish the questions before the break. Yeah. And they will curse you. It's not me.
Christmas will change their hearts towards me. Christmas. So, this one says, good evening, counselors.
Good evening.
This man came into my life 2.5 months ago. Whenever we meet, however, he's always asking for us to caress, smooch, kiss. He's 57 and I'm 45. Should I continue with this relationship or stay away? I've never been married, neither has he. But I have a 27-year-old girl. Please advise.
We even agree. She's 45. The man is 57. The only problem is that anytime the man comes, they do what they are not supposed to do. So she's asking if she should continue with the relationship.
She has a daughter who's 27-year-old.
50-something. I don't know whether the man has married before.
No,
she hasn't, but she didn't talk about the man. But she was specific, says, I haven't married before.
That she has a child.
Yeah.
And so for 50-something-year-old man to come into your life, two and a half months, you know.
Oh, he came only 2.5 months ago.
Yes, 2.5 months ago.
I think
it's too early to even conclude, because why has the man stayed all these years without marrying? 50-something, what prevented him from marrying? If he married before, what happened to those marriages? If he's been in relationships or whatever. My piece of advice for the lady is that 2.5 is too early. He should, because of the ages, they should really steady themselves. The only worrying side is the man forcing her to have that kind of, you know, thing with her. It's a red flag. Mm-hmm. I mean, is he somebody who will really, does he love her? That's the question. Does he love her, and what kind of love is he exhibiting here? If you love somebody, why can't you help her or help him to keep that purity with his God or her God until you come to the altar with the partner? So there are a few things that the lady has to. 40 something, we know, is quite a journey. You've waited for all these years. Don't rush into the relationship only to regret it. Let them know the man very well. Get more information. If he has friends, you can get information from some of the friends, family members. If you belong to a church and he also belongs to a church, this is the time to let the church leadership know, because marriage is not something you can go in and come out easily. You are not even expected to go in and come at all. Once you go, you are to stay in. That is the design of God. So 2.5 months, she should still wait and help the man to keep some quote righteousness in this relationship. I will also not rush to say that the man is somebody that she should just run away from. If he doesn't know and he needs help, I think help can come in. But the lady should wait for the man to be helped and be well positioned, because 50 something without marriage, we have a lot of questions to ask. We have a lot of questions. He has a lot of questions to answer. Why he has been waiting all these years? What was he waiting for? And what kept him waiting? Once the answers are clear, why not? 40 something and 50 something, they can come into the
relationship. Reverend Derek, do you have anything to say? Is it why the man waited?
Reverend Agree makes it so humorous. Okay, so I'm wondering, is it possible for me to be preaching Christ to you and you asking me to give you a kiss and so on? In other words, what kinds of conversations do you engage in when you meet? Watch where you meet. Watch what you watch when you are together. Watch the places you go, the kinds of music you listen to. Watch your conversations. If you watch these things and you would put safety measures in place, I think that you would be able to protect the relationship. If he wants to kiss you, caress you, that is fine within the context of marriage. So then encourage him to marry you so that he can do all of these things, you know, with your cooperation and with your with a clear conscience on your part. So I like Reverend Agri said, sometimes I feel that, okay, so this lady had been believing God for a relationship, mama.
Okay.
And the interval between her last unsuccessful relationship and the next one that came was about 7 years.
Okay.
You know, and she had been really believing God for a man. Then she came to church one day, and I prophesied and said, within the space of 3 months, God is going to open a door for you. People are going to come into your life. Among all the people that will come, your husband, is future husband, is one of them.
Okay.
So just pray about it and be ready. According to her, a total of 5 men came.
Wow.
You know, and I told her to be in chat with Mama Della and so on. And she was able to settle on one prayerfully. Then one day, I asked Mama Della, so how is their relationship going? She said, oh, your daughter sacked the guy. I said, why? What happened? She said, according to her, the guy came to visit her and wanted to do the thing. So she slapped him and said, you devil, get away from me. And I said, after 7 years of waiting.
Oh.
So when I had a chance to engage her, I told her that one thing you must know is that it's easier for men to get tempted and aroused
than
for you women.
Yeah.
And the fact that she wanted to do that does not make him a devil.
Yeah.
Going back to David, a man after God's own heart, but he had some feelings and he couldn't control it, so it led to this. So when he asked you for that, all you should have told him
is a no.
Was a no, and be firm in your no, and reason with him.
That's right. Say and the reasons for your no.
Exactly. And tell him that, you know what, I love you, you love me. Let's start counseling.
Yeah.
After marriage, I am all yours and all of that. These words could have restrained him, and your wisdom would have endeared you to him. But to jam him a slap, open the door and sack him. Are you prepared to wait for the next 7 years? When would your waters be stirred again? You know, so but it was too late. I mean, she had just driven the man away because he did something which was not, you know. So I'm saying to you that if you are in a relationship and the guy is born again, maybe a mighty man, maybe a pastor, whoever, it doesn't mean that he would not feel all those things towards you. It is easy for all those feelings, you know, to manifest. When I was telling her, but you, Reverend Derek, did you do that to Mama Della? I said, no. But it didn't mean that I didn't have those feelings.
Yeah.
I did, but I restrained them, I controlled them, and I contained them, you know. So, and I also never even told her.
Yeah.
So there are things you can do, but, you know, so you must understand this. And when he begins to make those demands, like I said, watch where you go.
Yeah.
Watch what you watch, the kind of television programs you watch. You know, if you are with him together, in the sitting room, you have given yourself a disco atmosphere and you are watching people doing things on television. Why won't he say, caress me? You can't walk on hot coals and say that your feet will not be blistered. So watch those things, you know, and anytime you want to visit him, go in the company of somebody, a friend, and so on. If you put these safety measures in place, you would be able to protect your relationship till you come to the altar and say, yes, I do. I think that these are some of the important things that you need to put in place. But hey, make sure that at your age, you don't lose the man, because 45, you know, you have passed the flower of your youth. And so just walk in wisdom. And start counseling immediately. If he's willing to go through counseling, then you know he's serious. But if he begins at 57 to put off the counseling and he's not serious about going to see your parents, doing the what must be done, then you must know that he just wants to hit and run. You need to apply wisdom. That's what I would have to say.
So I think they've answered it. Get to know him. Number one, anytime he comes with the kisses and the caressing and whatever, say it's a big no. Number one is a no because you are born again. No, because you don't want anybody taking advantage over you. No, because you've waited so long and you are not about to make a mistake.
That's right.
So it's a big no.
That's right. I like that.
It's a big no.
I like that.
If he's decent enough and he loves you enough, he would abide by this and he would wait. But the truth is that the fact that you said no today doesn't mean that tomorrow when he comes, he won't feel the same thing.
Mm.
So say no. Say no, say no. And like Reverend Derek said, when he comes, be careful the kind of conversations you have, where you sit. If you have a one-bedroom house, where would you take him to your bedroom?
Exactly.
Sit outside with him.
Yeah.
Even in the hall, if nobody is there, your daughter is not there, sit outside. When you also go to visit him, don't go into his room. Sit outside with him. And then get to know him, build his relationship, build your relationship. Find out, like Reverend Agri is saying, at 57, what happened? Have you been married before? And when you got married, what happened? If you've never been married before, why all the... I mean, ask questions.
Yeah.
Don't rush because you've waited till 45. So anybody that comes, you jump into it. Ask questions. Tell him you belong to a church. Go with him, introduce him to your pastor, and go with him, introduce him to your parents. If he's ready for all these things, then now you can start counseling. And whilst you are doing counseling, certainly he has friends. I always say that we are in a global village.
Yeah.
There's bound to be somebody that knows him. Find out. Ask questions.
Yeah.
What happened to his other relationship? How many relationships has he been to? How many women has he married? Reverend Agri and I counseled somebody who came and said she's met somebody. We went into the case. We realized that the man has married three women. First one, separated. Second one, separated. Wow. Third one, separated.
Wow.
And this lady was a member of our church. And that's for Reverend Agri. I love Reverend Agri. Reverend Agri has time. We'll go into the case. So we went into the case and we realized that he is the cause, not the women. We invited one of the women here, asked questions. The woman said, the man is like this, the man is like this, the man is like this. This lady said, no. The women are lying. All three women are lying.
Wow.
You'll be the fourth liar. We spoke to her. She didn't listen. The following week, here we were, she was distributing invitation cards for her engagement.
Wow.
And she did it in such a way that, like, Reverend Agri and I will know that, yes, we didn't mind her. I think 3 or 4 years after, I went to Maryland, our church in Maryland. Then it wasn't grace to grace. This lady comes. Mama Rita, here's your stone. I said, which kind of stone? What are you talking about? Said, Mama Rita, I said, here's your stone. I said, what stone? He said, said everything you and Reverend Agri said about the man is true. Today, they are divorced. I don't know how many other women have come after her. So please, take your time, get to know him, and find out from other people who know him. If your pastors and your marriage counselors want to dive deep into knowing him, please let them do it. At 57, the truth is that it's not normal. But maybe the wife died. Maybe he's divorced, maybe the marriage didn't work. We won't totally blame him, but go into it, get to know him. Once you get to know him and everything is okay, why not go ahead and then get married? I think our time is up. We thought we could take one more question, but the answers. But Pastor Chief Ape said, one question and the answers we'll give would answer so many other questions. So sometimes we might not read your questions, but you realize that if you listen well, Some of the answers we give from some of the questions will actually answer your problem and your situation. We will come your way same time next week.
I mean, someone says, I'm enjoying the show. I'm man power.
I'm glad you have enjoyed. Make time with us same day, same time next week. Number one, we'll be doing two things or three things. We'll be doing question time, ask Mama Rita. We'll be doing phone-ins with your
testimonies
and how much we have affected you and what your marriage is like and your relationship like through family life. And then whatever you also want to see and hear in season three, you can let us know. And remember, next week will be our last session for season two. We will go on a break for Christmas. We want everybody to enjoy your Christmas with your wife and your children. If you want to send us pictures of the dinner you had and the breakfast you had on the 25th,
they can actually tell us the plans they have next week.
Yes, you can even tell us the plans you have. If you want to surprise your wife, let us know. We will help you surprise your wife. I am a masterpiece when it comes to surprises.
International planner.
We will help you surprise your wife or your husband. But make a date with us same day, same time next week. But until then, please take good care of yourself. There's so much flu in the system. So much flu. It might not be COVID, but it's either your throat, you are sneezing, and you are coughing, whatever. But don't just assume it's flu. Yeah. Go to the hospital, let them determine whether it is a flu or it is COVID. And if COVID hasn't gone yet, my darling, take good care of yourself. Your vitamin C, your natural sunlight, sunshine, or your vitamin D and your zinc. And then do your concoction, ginger, garlic, and the lemon. Blend everything together. Drink one teaspoon in warm water and honey every day. If you have the COVID, you are told you have the COVID, and it's not too serious, you can do it maybe two or three times with a concoction every day. And then the vitamin C, you can increase it 1,000 in the morning and 1,000 in the evening, according to how your tummy will take. And then for those of you who sit in public transport, please, when you sit in the public transport, wear your mask. I went to a program and everybody was hugging themselves. So I asked, has COVID gone and me, I haven't heard. Everybody, somebody came hugging me, a Reverend Pastor Rodney got angry. I mean, now we are
living our lives normally, as if nothing normally has happened.
And trust me, normally during Christmas,
exactly,
the COVID shoots up because of all the parties and the gatherings. And the jamming. And what I'm not saying don't enjoy your life, please do.
But
observe the COVID protocols. That's take precautions, right. Please. Everywhere you go, go with your mask. And when you are on the dance floor dancing, please, a lot of COVID spreads during the dance floor when everybody has removed this. And what I have realized, all the weddings within this COVID period, after the weddings, so many people get COVID.
Wow.
Correctly so.
Because they are partying. Everybody has removed their masks.
That's right.
They are jumping clothes.
The micro droplets just
that
spread.
Is it. Yeah. And then normally we are on the table, and unfortunately, even some of the churches these days don't observe the. You go and everybody is sitting down normally.
Yeah.
Normally.
Not wearing the mask.
Not wearing the mask.
Not observing social distance.
I went to some church and I asked, right house, are we doing too much?
Yeah.
I mean,
you always feel like that when you go to.
Exactly. Campus. That's very true.
People were not washing their hands.
Very, very true.
People were not wearing masks. And they were sitting close to each other.
You rather start feeling odd.
No, you feel odd.
Right.
You feel odd. I went to a church in Texas. I was forced to remove my mask because it was like Mitre Bibidodo. There was nobody in the service wearing masks.
Wow.
So anytime I went there with my mask, I felt so uncomfortable. It was like, ah, bye. Why are you the only one?
Where is your God?
Please. And then the pastors who are saying that the people who wear the masks are faithless, my darling, go back and read your Bible. Go back and read your Bible. Let's be one another's keeper. Yep. Let's take good care of ourselves. And let's not forget the aged in society. That we have aged in society. We have children in society. We need to protect.
Yeah.
Take good care of yourself. And trust me, both of us, or all of us, you and me, we are celebrating 31st December in grand style. And we are entering into year 2022. I want to see everybody alive, you and me. We are entering. God bless you, and I love you. I forgot my oh my God.
Hi, WMG, the shakers and the movers of our time and our generation, the true sons and daughters of the Apostle General and Mama Rita, the children that we are about to hand over our inheritance and the inheritance of the kingdom of God. It is your gathering, the end of year, Thanksgiving, celebration, praise, jumping, dancing, glorifying God for how far He has brought us. Some of our members have successfully graduated from the universities. Some, in course of the year, got their breakthroughs. Some are yet to get their breakthroughs. And maybe you are one of those that is yet to get your breakthrough. Make a date with me, the 17th of December, 9 p.m. sharp, at Royal House Chapel, Ahimfie, Obechebi Lamte Interchange. Come with your friends. Come with your jeans and your sneakers and your t-shirts and your sandals. Come with a fervency to pray. Come with a heart and a cup to receive fresh oil for the year 2022. And I'll be sharing the theme for the year 2022 with you as we prepare ourselves for the Shakers and Movers Conference 2022. I am expecting you. Mama Rita is going to be there. All the WMG leaders are going to be there. And it's going to be heaven on earth. Come, let's dance. Come, let's pray. Come, let's praise God. Come and receive a prophetic word. Come and receive a change. Come and receive transformation. Come and receive power. Come so that you too will start laughing. I love you. I will see you there.
Another Christmas is here with us again. Christmas is a season of love. In Royal House Chapel, we are noted for showing love. We show love to our senior citizens. We show love to School of Restoration. School of Restoration is a group for